Good morning, everybody, and welcome to the 21st meeting of the award-winning Rural Affairs and Islands Committee in 2024. Before we begin, can I ask everyone to ensure that their electronic devices are switched to silent. This morning we have apologies from Eleanor Whittam, and we welcome back to the committee Karen Adam as a substitute. Our first item of business is to consider whether to take item 3 in private. Are we all agreed? Thank you. Our next item of business today is an evidence session on the Scottish Government's policy priorities and programme for government commitments relevant to the committee's remit. And welcome to the meeting Mary Goujon, the Cabinet Secretary for Rural Affairs, Land Reform and Islands, and Jim Fairley, Minister for Agriculture and Connectivity. And joining us from the Scottish Government, we have George Burgess, the Director of Agriculture and Rural Economy, Donald Henderson, the Deputy Director from the Nature Division, Malcolm Pentland, the Deputy Director and the Lead for Marine Economy and Communities, and Ian Wallace, the Head of Operations Portfolio from the Marine Directorate. We've got about 2 hours for discussion this morning, but before we begin, can I ask the Cabinet Secretary for a brief opening statement.
Thank you very much, convener. And together with the Minister for Agriculture and Connectivity, Jim Fairley, we are happy to be with the committee this morning to discuss the priorities of the Rural Affairs, Land Reform and Islands portfolio over the course of the coming year. Now, Scotland's rural economy is a major source of growth for Scotland and delivers an economic contribution worth £39 billion, which is 26% of the Scottish total in GVA in 2021. Yet, we do know that communities across rural Scotland and our islands face a number of unique challenges. That includes the higher costs of living, so we are determined to make sure that these challenges are addressed across all of our policies. Now, as we've set out in the programme for government, just some of the key pieces of work that will be undertaken for the benefit of those who live in our rural and island communities. The publication of a new National Islands Plan in 2025 and the forthcoming Rural Delivery Plan will set out how we will support our island and rural communities. The Carbon Neutral Islands Project is beginning to show how islands can take forward climate action that supports communities sustainably and supports resilience at the same time as reducing emissions. I'm also looking forward to taking the next steps on our Good Food Nation journey, which includes laying the National Good Food Nation Plan in Parliament. In terms of seafood, I will focus on securing quota and providing the regulatory frameworks to enable fisheries businesses to operate alongside ensuring the long-term sustainability of fish stocks. The Agriculture Reform Programme will deliver on our vision for agriculture, continuing to support farmers and crofters to reduce emissions and deliver biodiversity improvements through greater uptake of key baseline activities such as carbon and biodiversity audits and soil analysis. Forestry is one of Scotland's success stories, and we plan to build on this through the planting of 10,000 hectares of woodland this year. And we also remain committed to protecting animal health and welfare and plant health. Working jointly with partners, we will ensure we meet our statutory obligations and, crucially, safeguard trade, protect public health and maintain our highest possible standards. When it comes to legislation, it will of course be a busy year for the portfolio and no doubt for the committee too, with our commitment to take forward 3 key pieces of legislation. The crofting bill will make crofting regulation less onerous for active crofters and the Crofting Commission, provide clarity in law and introduce some immediate positive outcomes for crofters and their communities, and it will also allow the Crofting Commission to better regulate crofting. The Natural Environment Bill, which is led by the Acting Cabinet Secretary for Net Zero and Energy, Gillian Martin, contain elements relating to national parks and deer management, which sit within both mine and Mr Fairley's portfolios, and we will be supporting the bill's introduction. I will also continue to take forward work on the Land Reform Bill, which was introduced to Parliament in March, which of course is currently being scrutinised by the NZ Committee. The bill sets out ambitious proposals that will change for the better how land is owned and managed in our rural and island communities. And with that, convener, this is just a brief overview of some of the work that will be undertaken across the portfolio, but with that I'm happy to take any questions that both yourself and the committee members may have.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. We've got various themes which will touch on the priorities that you've mentioned, but just to begin with, more specifically, can you give us an idea of the timing of the Crofting Bill, when we're likely to see the Good Food Nation Plan, when the Natural Environment Bill is likely to be introduced, to give us a kind of indication of what the work programme for us might look going forward?
I'm happy to provide as much information as I possibly can. I think I'll hand over to Mr Fairley, who can give more of an update in relation to how the work is developing on crofting. In relation to some of the other work that you've mentioned there, the Good Food Nation Plan, obviously we have a deadline by which we have to introduce the plan. The committee will no doubt be aware that we undertook consultation on the first draft of the plan, which was very extensive, and we did receive a significant response to that consultation through, which we're currently working through to update the draft that we have at the moment before laying that in Parliament. So we of course fully intend to lay that before the deadline, which is the 30th of June next year, I believe. And then obviously the Parliament has 60 days to scrutinise it from then, and then we have another 3 months from that point before we lay a draft final plan. But of course I will keep the committee updated on that work as it progresses. And just to touch briefly on the Natural Environment Bill as well, I hope the committee can appreciate it's not for me to say when that bill is going to be introduced yet, and I'm not the lead minister on that bill, though as I touched on in my opening remarks, there are elements of the bill which are relevant to this portfolio itself. Of course, there was a consultation on some of the measures in relation to that, and of course we're working through the consultation responses in developing the proposals that would form a part of that legislation too. And with that, I'll hand over to Mr Fairley.
Good morning, and good morning, committee. And congratulations on being an award-winning committee. I thoroughly enjoyed watching your speech and your photographs on Thursday evening at the Holyrood Magazine Award. Well done. In terms of the timing of the bill, you'll be aware that we have gone through the consultation process and our officials are now looking at the contents and what people have fed back into that. The priorities in the bill are to help people, more people become crofters and to better support the existing crofters and their businesses. We want to enable more and different activity to be undertaken on common grazings, including empowering the Crofting Commission to tackle breaches through a more streamlined process, and to resolve crofting regulated issues more quickly through new and revised powers for the Crofting Commission. I think there's been 15 engagements throughout the crofting regions, and that work will now all be put into the mix, as it were, and we will be... I've actually got some visits myself to crofting communities to go and speak to people and to get their face-to-face conversations about what it is that they are looking from the bill. But it will be introduced in this parliamentary session, possibly the end of this year, beginning of next year.
OK, thank you. We'll now go and look at these themes in a bit more detail. I'm going to kick off by... Sorry. Ariane.
Thanks. Sorry. Apologies. Thanks, convener, and good morning. I've got a couple of questions. Before I go to my main question, Cabinet Secretary, you touched on the Good Food Plan. Could you just tell us a little bit about the Good Food Nation, the Food Commission, and how the process is going for that?
Yes, absolutely. I mean, obviously, I brought forward the regulations to the committee earlier this year. We had announced that we've appointed a chair of the commission, and that was just a few weeks ago in mid-August, and Dennis Overton has been appointed as the chair. So that's a really important first step in establishing the commission. And of course, we'll be looking to recruit further members from there and from that point. We want to make sure that the Commission is up and running at the same time as we're introducing the plan. We think that timeline makes sense, but of course I'm happy to keep the committee updated as that work progresses.
Okay, thanks. And then just a follow-on, and I know you said that the Natural Environment Bill is not, you're not fully leading on that, but the Programme for Government stated that the bill will provide powers to update environmental impact assessments and habitats legislation to support delivery of our net zero and biodiversity goals. And I'd be interested to hear if you foresee that those powers could be used to extend requirements for EIAs across all sectors, or is it the intention to streamline the EIA process or something else?
I'd be happy to follow that up with my colleague if that would be helpful for the committee, because again, that's not an area of policy that I'm leading on directly, so I'm just reluctant to say anything in particular about that at the moment. As I say, the areas that are relevant for this portfolio are largely in relation to national parks and deer management as well, but I'll follow that up with colleagues and be happy to provide more information.
Thanks very much.
Just on, you touched on deer management. Is that likely to be part of the Natural Environment Bill, or will it be separate policies coming forward to the committee to deal on a case-by-case basis? How's that going to appear?
Again, well, at the moment, in relation to the Natural Environment Bill, it's as what's been set out in the PFG, so it talks about, well, updating and modernising the National Parks legislation and also deer management featuring as part of that as well. So that is the intention at the moment.
So we're not likely to see individual pieces of deer legislation coming out with that bill?
I'm not anticipating that at the moment. I think it's about using this as the vehicle for which we would need to introduce any changes via primary legislation.
Okay, thanks very much. So, yeah, we're going to go on to theme two, looking at the climate and biodiversity plans, and question from Marianne Burgess.
Thanks, convener. Obviously the climate change plan has been delayed, and I think we'd be interested to hear how it will impact on the development of rural policy, and in particular ensuring the forthcoming rural support plan and other aspects of agricultural reform align with the new five-year carbon budgets.
Yes, I'm happy to respond to that. And of course, no doubt the committee members will be aware that the climate change bill has just been introduced. That will be getting scrutinised, I believe, by the NZ committee as well, who've started taking evidence on that. Now, I would say in relation to how agricultural policy is developing, as I've mentioned, and talked about quite extensively at committee previously, we've set out our programme and our roadmap for agricultural reform and set out the timescales at which we expect changes to be implemented, when the information about those changes will be introduced as well. But of course, we have obligations according to the legislation, which was passed by the Scottish Parliament just before the summer recess, and in the Agriculture and Rural Communities Scotland Act, which mean that we have to have cognizance and have regard to the climate change plan, the policies within it, as we're developing our rural support plan. So we will, of course, be doing that. I mean, all of these policies go hand in hand, whether it's in relation to climate change and biodiversity and how we develop our policies going forward. So we'll very much be working closely with colleagues in climate change as the plans are developing and feeding in through that process, as well as taking forward the programme that we've set out. But what I would say in relation to the current proposals for the climate change bill, as it's been published in this new proposal for carbon budgets, which was based on the advice of the CCC, I think that, I mean, if the legislation is passed as envisaged, obviously we would see the introduction of five-yearly carbon budgets then. I think that we would have to get the advice from the CCC as to what those carbon budgets would involve and what they would look like. And then the intention would then be to publish another climate change plan after that point as well. So I think there is still an awful lot of work to be undertaken within that. But I do know as well that, and no doubt colleagues across the table will be aware, that I think the Acting Cabinet Secretary for Net Zero and Energy, Gillian Martin, is going to be providing an update for MSPs next week to provide more information on all of this.
Okay, thanks for that. I've got a couple more questions. So regardless of when the next climate change plan is published, the 2019 Climate Change Act Section 35 states that the climate change plan must set out ministers' proposals and policies in relation to the reduction of whole farm greenhouse gas emissions through the use of many tools and approaches, including nutrient resource budgeting, organic farming and agroecology. And I'd like to know if the Scottish Government is on track to set out such policies, and will there be sufficient money in tiers 2 through 4 to support the majority of farmers to adopt these approaches?
I mean, that is the key question, and I know that we've discussed at length the budget. I mean, the fact is we don't have any clarity on what future budget is going to be. Obviously, if we're bringing forward policies, we want to make sure that we're adequately resourced and able to deliver them, and to deliver on the ambitions that are set out in our vision for agriculture, and to implement the change and the transformation that I think we all want to see, really working with our farmers and crofters as they work to produce food, but do so in a way that reduces their emissions and also enhances nature and delivers on our ambitions for biodiversity as well. So, of course, no doubt we will be keeping the committee updated as these proposals develop. Again, I can't say what's going to be in the carbon budgets or what that's going to look like or what advice we're going to receive. So I think it is a case of we need to see what information and advice we get from that as we look to develop the plans and proposals from there.
Do you have a timescale on that?
Again, all I have is basically what's been set out in relation to the climate change bill right now. I think that advice on the carbon budgets is expected to be around the spring next year. I mean, all of this, of course, depends on the passage of the bill and what comes out of that process. But I think that's what's anticipated at the moment. But again, I'm not the lead minister on that bill. That's at Gillian Martin, and she's offering that information and advice session next week.
So would you say that the work on the climate change, the climate bill, is that holding up your ability to move forward on making these decisions around the tier 2 to 4 budget allocations, or is it to do with the fact that you don't know what the budget allocation is coming from the UK?
Well, first of all, we don't know what the overall quantum of a budget is going to be, but also we're still to design some of those future tiers of the framework as well. So we set it in the roadmap when we expect each of the new tiers of the new framework to be introduced. So again, we're very much working according to that timeline.
Okay, thanks. And then I've got a question around the biodiversity delivery plan. And I'd be interested to hear what progress is being made on the key deliverables in the draft biodiversity delivery plan for 2024 to 25 as they relate to future agricultural policy and the rural support plan, fisheries, aquaculture and forestry, the whole lot.
Okay, there's a lot in there, so I'll try to get through as much as I can, and I might turn to Donald to be able to offer some more information on that. But I think that we're already delivering on that through a number of mechanisms and different streams of work we're taking forward through the Agricultural Reform Programme, as well as through current work and programmes that we have. So you'll no doubt be aware of the AICS scheme, and we use that to help deliver on the biodiversity ambitions that we have. We also, there's the conditions that are being introduced next year in relation to farming support and the introduction of the foundations of a whole farm plan, part of which is a package of audits that we're expecting farmers and crofters to undertake at least 2 out of the 5 options that are there. That includes biodiversity auditing. We've been working with Nature Scott on the development of a biodiversity app as well to help garner that information as to what's on farm. So there is quite a lot of work underway that will help us with that wider delivery. But Donald, I don't know if there's further information you'd like to add.
I think you largely covered it. George may have more to add on the specific application to farming and agriculture, but the biodiversity strategy sets out which exists in draft at the moment. We'll be finalising it during the remaining course of this year and publishing, but that sets out the overall strategy, the overall aims, and then how each sector delivers on that is a matter for that sector and Cabinet Secretary. You mentioned some of the ways, including the app, for instance, in terms of how farmers, sometimes through quite modest change, can make valuable contribution.
Can I just come back in there, because I asked about key deliverables also in, so it's good to hear about the agricultural delivery in relation to biodiversity, but also fisheries and aquaculture and forestry.
Yes, I mean, the delivery of that is embedded in the policies as we're working through them and looking to, right. Well, in terms of the work we're taking through in fisheries and aquaculture.
Can you give us an indication of progress?
I understand that I'll be coming to the committee in a few weeks to discuss aquaculture and the progress that we're making in relation to that as well, because, I mean, in our seas, we know that there are a number of pressures which we see impacting on not just in aquaculture, but on fish stocks more generally as well. We've also been working on the development. We've introduced the interim measures in relation to some of our inshore fishery stocks. We're also looking at wider measures more generally. Some of the work that we're taking forward is outlined in the programme for government as well. But, I mean, obviously, the work that's being... I suppose I just want to emphasise that the work that's being done in climate change and biodiversity isn't being done in isolation to all our policy areas. It's very much embedded in the changes and the transformation that we're implementing and very much features in all policy areas across the portfolio.
Forestry, anything in there that has been progressed?
In relation to forestry, there have been a number of improvements, for example, to the forestry grant scheme. When you look at the levels of planting that we've had over the course of the past couple of years, about 50% of what was planted was native woodland as well. I think it was around 15,000 hectares of planting over the course of last year. And as I say, about 50% of that was native planting. We're going to see the introduction of the well, the new UK forestry standard, so that will apply to all forestry applications after the 1st of October this year as well. So there are some quite significant changes within that as well about the species diversity, planting on peatland, so I think there will be a number of improvements that we'll see through that.
Great, thanks for giving that detail.
Thanks. I'm not sure I'm just clear exactly what you think the impacts are going to be on a delayed climate change plan. We are going to have new schemes to support low-carbon beef production and whatever will affect the Suckler Climate Group. Have reported on that. There'll be conditionality, almost certainly, in relation to the environment in legislation. So there must be an impact on you developing that. If we don't see a climate change plan laid in November, what is a likely impact on developing agriculture policy?
I would say that, I mean, personally to me, in the work that we're taking forward, we already know we've got really stringent targets to meet, and regardless of when a climate change plan comes forward, we still have the overall ambition to be net zero by 2045. We still have to report annually in terms of how we're doing on emissions as well, and we know that the targets that we've had for agriculture, as an example, are really stretching, and that is where the programme of work that we set out and the timeline in relation to that has been really important in terms of trying to illustrate how we intend to reduce emissions over that period of time and through and how we're doing that through the future framework of support and really incentivising the types of behaviour that we want to see. So we already know we've got these stringent targets to meet. So I think personally for me, regardless of when the climate change plan comes forward, that's not going to stop or inhibit any of that work, because we know we need to continue to work at pace to implement those changes.
Okay, thank you. Question from Rhoda Grant.
On biodiversity and the impact of wildfires on that. So my understanding is the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service give evidence about how equipped they were to deal with wildfires. And they basically said estates are much better equipped than them. They don't have leaf blowers, they don't have all-terrain vehicles. So really, when a wildfire happens, they don't have the equipment. And it didn't seem very clear to me that there was any hope of them getting that anytime soon. I wonder if you've spoken to colleagues about that and how they can be better equipped.
I'd have to follow up with committee in relation to that, because obviously that area falls to Siobhan Brown and her role in community safety, but I'd be happy to follow up and provide more information to committee.
Thank you.
Do you mind if I just add a tiny point to that, convener? It should be noted that the relationship between estates, landowners, keepers and Scottish Fire and Rescue Service is a very good one, and it's one that has been, despite the difficulties I've taken through the Wildlife and Urban Management Bill, that relationship is very strong and they're working together. And I accept the point that Scottish Fire and Rescue Service want to have all the equipment that they'll need in order to tackle these things. But in remote and rural communities, as Mayor well knows, it relies on the local community to be part of that. And I think that relationship is one that we need to continue to foster and nurture.
Just before we move on again, you touched on progress with the key deliverables in the draft biodiversity delivery plan. How is that going to affect the rural support plan when it's published?
Again, as it's set out, and I think it's described in detail, I think, in the legislation that we passed and in the and through the various amendments to the bill in relation to the rural support plan, I think all the different areas that we have to have regard to. But again, we're not dealing with these policies in isolation. So, of course, whatever is set out in relation to the biodiversity strategy, the delivery plan, and then, of course, there will be the Natural Environment Bill, which will underpin some of that in legislation too, will, of course, feature as we're developing the future agricultural support system and framework.
Okay, thank you. We're now going to move on to agricultural support reform. A question from Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you. We've teed me up nicely, convener. When will the rural support plan be published, Cabinet Secretary?
We will be aiming to, I think, publish the rural support plan next year. I mean, as I hope you can appreciate, As I just outlined, in relation to the amendments that were passed through the legislation, there are a number of requirements set out in that in terms of the engagement that we have to undertake in relation to the preparation of the rural support plan. So we couldn't then take forward that work without having that legislation passed first and then knowing what must be included through that. So the intention would be to lay that next year. But as the timelines on that become clearer, of course, I'll be keeping the committee up to date on that.
And would the same apply to the Code of Practice on Sustainable and Regenerative Farming and also the secondary legislation?
Again, I know that the committee's asked me previously about the programme for secondary legislation, and I think as the further detail on that emerges, and we will provide as clear a timeline on that as we possibly can. In relation to the Code of Practice, of course, we have obligations in the legislation as part of the development of that. We've started early engagement on that, and we're due to consult on that this year. So my hope would be to publish that again next year.
The Rural Development Plan was announced a year ago by the Scottish Government, and there has been questions from stakeholders around the significant resource and ministerial time that this has taken so far, but it has delivered nothing so far that is tangible for rural communities. Would you accept the concern that farmers have of the time this is taking?
Sorry, do you mean are you meaning the Rural Delivery Plan instead?
Rural Delivery Plan.
Okay, and because, of course, the Rural Delivery Plan is an entirely separate strand of work. But, I mean, the plan hasn't been published yet, and the commitment was to lay a plan this parliamentary term. But there are a number of key strands of work that are being taken forward as part of that. And, of course, we're also developing a new National Islands Plan as well. And that relates largely to outlining how we're delivering for rural Scotland and how we will deliver for rural Scotland in relation to the policies that we'll be introducing. It's talking about how we better make evidence-based decision making, so establishing some of the key performance indicators that we need to monitor progress against that, how we are improving communication tools, and that rural mainstreaming as well, and looking at the development of a rural lens toolkit that we can use. So that work is still very much ongoing. We have a ministerial working group in relation to that that is helping to bring that work forward. But it's also going to build on work that's been done previously. We've had the National Council for Rural Advisors and all the recommendations that come out of that work. So the intention of this is very much not to duplicate what's been done before, but to build on that. But again, we are still on track for publishing that, and we've committed to do that this parliamentary term. And of course, I'll be making the committee aware of that.
I think it might be helpful for the committee to understand how much ministerial time and resource has been put in to developing the Rural Delivery Plan, so that we can understand what significant investment in resource has been put into it to achieve the sort of output that is expected from the key performance indicators and all the things that you've talked about. It's important that we do see value for money, I suppose. But I'd like to move on specifically to some of the previous funding. I mean, in total, we saw 100 million cut from rural affairs, from 32 million for the forestry grant scheme, 5 million nature restoration fund, 33 million from the support funding from the Bew review, 28 million in further rural affairs funding, and it amounts to 100 million in cuts. How can the Scottish Government expect food producers, land managers and farmers to deliver on the environmental objectives and produce food at the same time whilst cutting the budget?
To point out in relation to some of that and some of the savings that you've mentioned there. Again, we have continued to support our farmers and crofters through the transition. There are some figures that you mentioned there, and obviously you touched on the 33 million. There's £46 million that is due to be returned to the portfolio from savings that had previously been offered, but they were from underspends. They were not taken directly from the pockets of farmers and crofters, and we have maintained those payments, which I'm particularly proud of at a time when we know that our farmers and crofters need that support. And I think particularly through, and we've offered that support through the Preparing for Sustainable programme that we funded, in helping to encourage the uptake of carbon audits, soil testing, animal health and welfare plans as well, because we are wanting to support that transition and help our farmers and crofters as much as possible. So I think, yes, savings have been made, savings have had to be made right across government to meet the budget position that we're in, but we are still delivering, we're getting those payments out the door, and we are helping with this transition.
Okay, and do you expect that money to be returned in the timetable that was previously promised, now that Shona Robson has announced sort of $500 million in cuts?
Well, we haven't had the budget for the forthcoming year, but of course all of that is subject to discussions with the Cabinet Secretary for Finance.
Thank you.
Just on that, and we're not going to dwell on the budget because we'll be coming back to that in future sessions. But the Bureau of Review suggested, and I know you've said that farmers are still getting their payments and those have not been cut, but the Bureau of Review suggested there should be an additional $61 million going to farmers. That effectively, that's what the shortfall was. Where in the agricultural portfolio is that $61 million not being spent and therefore having an impact on, you know, progressing towards your goals?
If you're talking about the whole quantum of funding, I mean, as the committee will be aware, and as we touched on in the Budget Committee appearance at the start of this year, £15 million of that was returned to the portfolio. There's £46 million that are still to be returned. Now, largely, that was from areas that had been underspent or where it wouldn't have been possible for us to spend that budget within that allocation, which is why those savings had to be returned. But again, they will be getting returned to the portfolio, have that commitment from the Cabinet Secretary for Finance. But again, those discussions will be ongoing in relation to the upcoming budget.
Okay, thank you. Rhoda Grant.
It's not on exactly the same issue. I mean, the BUSE money came because some of our farmers, and especially crofters, were receiving less than average payments for their land. When that money comes back to the budget, can you give an assurance that that will be used to actually increase the amount that people get per hectare, especially those doing most to be carbon neutral, crofters and hill farmers and the like, who really were due that money?
I mean, I think all of that has to be taken into consideration, and I think there's a few important points to outline here. I mean, in terms of some of the funding that had been returned for capital, that went directly in relation to supporting some of the programmes we run for the Croft House Grant, the Crofting Agricultural Grant Scheme as well, and we want to make sure that that money is used for the benefit of our farmers and crofters. And we've also been, we've had the National Test Programme, the Preparing for Sustainable Farming Programme that I outlined in terms of some of the audits that we've been supporting and helping to encourage, and that's to help businesses get that better understanding of their baselines and their performance, and to ensure there are efficiencies from that and they can learn from the work that they've undertaken. And that's where I think utilising that has been really helpful. But of course, regardless, and again, all of this is subject to discussions. We don't know what any future allocations are going to be as well, but we will continue to engage with stakeholders in the development of any proposals for the use of funding going forward.
Just to push you a little on that, the money was specifically given because Scottish farmers and crofters were receiving less, a lot less than the average through Europe per hectare. And if this money is not used to increase that amount of money going to them, then it's not being used for the purpose it was given for.
No, but that's where, I mean, I think it's also important to remember that we also continue to fund some schemes in Scotland that simply don't exist elsewhere now and don't exist in Europe, that are directly helping our farmers and crofters. When you look at ELFAS as an example of that, and we'd made a commitment to continue with that funding, recognising how important it is for our farmers and crofters as well. So that's something that we continue to fund that isn't being funded elsewhere, and it's moved to a completely different model elsewhere in Europe too. We've got to make sure that we're utilising our funding and doing what's best for the farmers and crofters in Scotland, and that's exactly the programme that we're developing and we're delivering.
I'm going to come back to, you know, you said you were proud that you continued paying farmers at the level, but an independent review suggested that Scottish farmers were being shortchanged by £61 million. That's the Bureau review. So where would that £61 million where should it be spent? Are you saying that they don't actually need it and we can get through and the payments are adequate? You know, it's effectively £61 million was identified, as Rhoda said, that Scottish farmers were being underpaid. So where is the challenges in the budget, because that £61 million is not being paid out to farmers?
The £61 million, I think, to be absolutely clear on that, I mean, is that the overall figure you're referencing?
From
the ring-fenced funding that is still to be returned. Of course, I know that that is hugely important for farmers and crofters. It's ring-fenced and it's being returned to the portfolio. Now, I can't tell you right now exactly what that will be spent on or how it will be utilised, because again, that's subject to discussions with the Cabinet Secretary for Finance to work out the profiling of when that funding will be returned.
I suppose the question is, what impact is not having that £61 million that was identified by an independent inquiry, what is the impact having on our farmers?
Again, the £61 million was largely from unspent funds or funds.
No, it was the Bew Review identified that Scottish farmers should get paid an additional £61 million.
I'm sorry, but the figure that you're referencing there, I mean, I know there's the £61 million of the ring-fence funding, but
okay, maybe I should start from the other side. What is your understanding of the Bew Review and the money that was identified that should be extra money that should be coming? What's your understanding of the Bew Review?
My understanding of the Bew Review, and George may come in with more clarity in the detail on this, the Bew Review was because over a period of time, hill farmers in particular in Scotland were paid less than what other areas of the UK were paid. Now, you will remember the campaign that went on for a number of years to try to get the parity in terms of the payment over the area-based payments. And this was to'd and fro'd for a number of years. And it was, I can't remember what the exact figure was, but I think it was about £120 million that was identified that should have come to Scottish farmers that had been held by the UK government. Now, the Bew Review was done largely through Jim Walker. It was him that did the negotiation. And the funding that they had identified through that was then allocated to the Scottish Government, and this was back in Fergus Ewing's time as the Cabinet Secretary. So those conversations were then going on, and I do remember there was a bit of to and fro between Government and NFUS as to how that money should be allocated. My understanding is that some of that money was allocated to try to create a funding system that would allow farmers to buy capital projects. So the £61 million, I don't think, is entirely related to Bew. It was money that couldn't be allocated because farmers couldn't get access to the equipment that they needed at a particular time. They couldn't get the materials, the raw materials were missing. So there's a bit of a confusion as to around what the £61 million is and what the Bew Review was doing. Now, I don't think we're clear yet at this stage of the final readout from the Bew Review. I think there's some of that is still to be implemented by the UK government. But George will have far better clarity than I will on that one.
I think Mr. Burley has given a good historical account of the Bew process. I don't recognise the figure of £61 million in relation to Bew. The £61 million is the savings that have been found from this portfolio, as the Cabinet Secretary has outlined, money that was not going to be spent, and that we've actually effectively got the IOU from the Finance Secretary that money will be coming back into the portfolio. A tranche of that, yes, is Bew money that was allocated quite late in the day by the UK government. 2 years ago now, I think, at a point when it was difficult for us to accommodate in spending plans. Since then, the Bew allocation is simply, it's mainstreamed within the rural budget. It's not separately identified by the UK government in the ring fencing letter that has been set out. As Mr. Fairley says, there is some elements of the Bew Review that have yet to be implemented. Perhaps the key recommendation was discussion and agreement between the four UK administrations about future funding. That is a matter that the Cabinet Secretary has written to the new DEFRA Secretary of State, and we would hope to engage with DEFRA as soon as Monday on that issue. But given the complexity of this about, you know, the Scottish budget and savings and BEW, it might be something that it would be better for us to write to the committee, perhaps ahead of the budget session in a fortnight's time.
In terms of the ongoing negotiations, that the point, I think, that the clarification of what BEW is actually going to deliver, I think currently Scotland gets about 17% of the UK envelope of funding, and we want to make sure that Scotland gets at least 17%, given the weight that is put on Scottish agriculture in terms of the climate mitigations that we want to bring in, the food production, the natural environment stuff. We need to get at least 17% of that overall UK funding package, and hopefully we can get a funding package that is increased from the current levels from where they are at the moment. So, and that hopefully that engagement between ourselves and the UK government is a collegiate one where they understand what it is that we're trying to do in the rural portfolio in order to make Scotland carry out its climate change mitigations, continue to keep rural depopulation, stop rural depopulation, I should say, make sure we can continue to produce food and improve the biodiversity, all the things that we're trying to do. But none of that works unless we get that funding. So very much hope that the new UK government are in negotiating spirit when we actually start to meet them.
Okay, thank you. Arianne Burgess.
Thanks, Convener, and you've queued me up very nicely here. So, just going into a little bit more detail there. So several stakeholders that I'm working with who've seen the rural support plan proposals say that they fall far short, and compared to previous commitments on transforming how farmers are supported. And they're concerned that my favourite topic, Tier 2, will not move beyond the greening status quo. If more farmers are to be supported to adopt sustainable regenerative agroecological approaches, then Tier 2 needs to have stronger conditions and more budget, at least within a couple of years. And so I've got a couple of questions on this one. First of all, I'd be interested to hear what work the Scottish Government is doing to explore how they can strengthen Tier 2 over time to support more farmers on more farmland to implement more measures.
In relation to the work on Tier 2, I mean, obviously, concerned to hear that from stakeholders about the Rural Support Plan, but of course, what I would say is that from the initial proposals of the Rural Support Plan, and I think where we ended up in legislation and what has to be set out as part of the Rural Support Plan, I think there was a lot more, and I think it was strengthened through the different amendments that we had to the legislation as well in terms of what it has to set out. But again, the real vehicle for delivering that change is going to be the secondary legislation, which we've already outlined in my response to Rachel Hamilton. We would be bringing forward in due course, and of course notifying the committee if we get more, once we're a bit clearer on what the timeframe for some of that is going to look like. But what I would say is we haven't introduced the Tier 2 measures yet. I mean, that is work that is still very much under development and that we're discussing as well. So I would say I wouldn't write off any of the measures that are in Tier 2 at the moment. We have, of course, though, announced as part of the update to the route map just before the summer that we'd be using the greening mechanism. And so that just means, essentially, from the user end, that nothing is really going to change in terms of how they interact with our systems over the course of the next few years. But, of course, we want to try to be ambitious with the programme, but we do realise this is going to be a period of transition, which is why we've set out and laid that out through the route map as to when those changes are going to be introduced. But, again, this is very much a work in progress.
OK, so connected to that, I'd be interested to hear to what degree you're looking at moving away from just area-based greening measures and adding whole business measures like no use of pesticides, minimal use of bag nitrogen, a percentage of feed sourced on farm?
I mean, when we're looking at specific measures, as I say, we'd published, I think, some of the areas that we were considering looking at as part of that. And we were very much looking to get feedback on that, and we still are as well, as to what should be included in Tier 2. So I'd say we've already set out some examples, and again, it doesn't even cover all areas at the moment, but it's based on the information and the science that we have as to measures that could be implemented and measures that could work. And we would also set out earlier this year as well that there are various pilot projects that we're looking to develop in relation to the use of methane inhibitors as an example of that. But as I say, we've published those measures. It's not definitive. It's still a work in progress. So it's not possible for me to commit to what's going to be in that and what's not.
And in terms of the national test programme, we've spoken about that, or you've spoken about that quite a few times at committee. I'd be interested to understand, given that we've got the new definition of soil biology in the Agricultural and Rural Communities Bill, are we going to expand what that test programme is going to involve in terms of farmers really looking at the soil biology rather than just the kind of chemical inputs?
Mm-hmm. No, thanks for that. And also, I mean, for all the work that we undertook during the course of the bill, because I think it is a lot stronger for some of those amendments that were introduced as well. But again, everything that formed part of that legislation will very much, there are a lot of items in there that we have to have regard to when we're going to be developing our future policy as well, of which that is one. So of course that will feature in our plans going forward. So again, I can't say definitively at this moment this will form part of, you know, some of the programmes or the funding streams that we have at the moment, but again, it is something that we will have regard to.
Is there a timescale on when you can start to say things more definitively?
Again, we've tried to set that out and set out as much information to be as clear as we can through the route map as to when more information is going to become available. As I've already said today, the Rural Support Plan is going to be published, and that's aiming to be published next year, obviously before the new part of the future framework is implemented with the enhanced tier, which is due to be introduced in 2026 as well. So there will, of course, be more information in relation to that, but I will be keeping the committee updated.
Thanks very much. And just to say, the rurals, the route map has been a very helpful tool, so thanks for that.
Thank you. And we now move on to our next theme, which is forestry, and a question from Emma Harper.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning to you all. I've got a couple of questions, actually, about forestry. I am going to come to the Royal Society of Edinburgh's report that was published in February, but I'd be interested just to hear about, like, forthcoming work streams and challenges for forestry and woodland creation. And I know forestry is a big industry for Scotland. It's £1.1 billion, I think, to Scotland's economy, and there's 34,000 jobs, and I know it's really important in the South Scotland region. So I'd be interested to hear an update about forestry.
No problem. There is, of course, like many other areas of the portfolio, an awful lot of work going on in relation to that as well. As you've highlighted, forestry is really critical, not just for our rural economy, but for our wider economy too. As you've outlined, it's worth £1.1 billion to our economy. It supports tens of thousands of jobs as well. And I think that there is so much more potential there. Because when you look at the statistics, we're one of the biggest importers of timber in the world, when we could be, you know, providing more of our own supply and using more of our own timber supply as well, and that would be the aim. There is no getting around the fact that this has been a really difficult year for forestry in terms of the budget. Some of those figures were touched on earlier, and some of the cuts to the woodland grant scheme, the forestry grant scheme that we've had this year. Especially on the back of last year, as I highlighted, we were able to plant 15,000 hectares of new trees, and half of that was native woodland as well. So that's the highest ever level that we've seen. And this year, we will, and over the coming year, we'll be able to plant around 10,000 hectares with the funding that we have at the moment. But what I would still say within that is that even with the 10,000 hectares, I think that's still about 75% of the overall planting that's happening within the UK too. I'd mentioned some of the work in relation to the updates to the UK forestry standard, which will apply to new projects as of next month. So I think that that's been an important piece of work. We'd undertaken a review and implemented some changes to the forestry grant scheme over the course of the past year as well, which I think touches on some of the points that were raised in the report from RSE. When we look at, you know, more planting alongside rivers, we want to ensure that farmers and crofters are able to plant more trees as well. So we've upped the support that's available at that smaller scale to enable more of that to happen. We also have the Integrating Trees Network, which has been really critical, I think, showcasing some of those examples and of how trees can be integrated into farming businesses as well. So the real focus this year has been on, with the funding that we do have, ensuring that we're maximising that as much as we possibly can and getting those trees in the ground and really utilising the funding as best we can. I would just say in relation to the RSE report as well, and obviously Ariane Burgess and myself, we'd had some discussions. I know there were some amendments put forward that in relation to the Agriculture Bill before the summer, and we'd had some discussions with RSE and with Scottish Forestry too, because I think there were some concerns with some of the issues that had been raised in the report. While there are points in it that we would welcome, but just to outline to committee that the dialogue between Scottish Forestry and RSE is ongoing in relation to some of the matters that they've raised there as well.
I mean, the RSE made 16 recommendations, and there was riparian planting was part of it, and looking at other issues, planting on peatland or deep peat being exempted, for instance. I know there was a bit of in the report, which I have in front of me, it talks about landowners basically getting public money, but actually the Scottish Government owns over 1 million acres, hectares. And National Trust owns land, and RSPB owns land as well. So it's not just about private land owners getting forestry grants. I was also looking at a response from Daniel Ridley Ellis, who's the head of Centre of Wood Science and Technology at Napier, who had brought out some points from the report. And I know you're saying that there are parts of the report that are positive that you would agree with, we can take on board. And then there's other parts about looking at relying on products that come from other countries. For instance, we do import 80% of our timber. And I would be interested in that aspect of the report, where, you know, we need to do what we can to not be so reliant on timber coming from elsewhere. Is that something that, obviously, if we improve planting and we support more forestation and woodland creation, we would then not rely on timber from other countries?
Yeah, and I think that there's a lot of work that can be done to improve that situation. I think some of the issues that you'd outlined there in relation to the planting on deep peat, some of those matters have been dealt with through the updates to the UK forestry standard that I've mentioned this morning. So the species diversity, the percentage of that has increased, or well, for a single species, it's reduced from 75% to 65% as well. There are also updates in that in relation to the planting on peat as well. So again, some of those areas are dealt with. I know that industry themselves had some concerns about the report, and I think some of what had been expressed in there, and Scottish Forestry as well, I think they've were disappointed that they hadn't been engaged in the process of the report. But as I say, the engagement since then has been positive, and having those discussions. I think what's important within all of that, though, is that we do need that mix. I think our native planting is, of course, hugely important, as is our productive forestry. And as with everything, I think it's about the balance and ensuring that we try to get the balance of that right. But our productive sector is, of course, critical for all the reasons that we've outlined today, and because of the wider economic impact of that too.
Okay, it's just a wee final question. You've mentioned 65%. So people talk about blanket Sitka. They just, when they're criticising tree planting, but 65% means that would be a conifer, and then the other 35% would be native. That is the current standard, am I right? So it's not just blanket Sitka, it's a mix of native broadleaf as well as conifer.
Yeah, there would be more of that mix. As I say, that's part of the new UK forestry standard, which will apply. So the single species has gone down from 75% to 65% as part of that new standard. But I would say that forestry now is very different to what it has been in previous generations and decades. They're not planned the same way now. They're not implemented and planted in the same way as what they would have been done generations ago. So I think that it is important to recognise, I think, the improvement improvements that have been made through that process. But it's also like many other areas, we're constantly looking to improve. I think that's where some of the discussions that we'd had through the bill were very helpful in setting some of that out. Community engagement is also hugely important as well, and we're looking to how we can improve that, working with some of the guidance that's been provided by the Scottish Land Commission as an example of that too. So I think that we are constantly striving to improve in terms of that wider engagement, but we also want to make sure that we've got that productive forestry, but we're also working, and we know that productive forestry also has a positive impact on our emissions, as does our wider native planting too, and some of the newer science that we've had. So it's getting that mix of it right, which is critical.
Okay, thanks.
Rhoda Grant.
And just a supplementary to that, I mean, there are concerns about greenwashing and people planting trees just to really improve their own reputation. There were press reports quite recently about an organisation getting grants, but very few of the trees had survived. What work is being undertaken to make sure that planting is for the right purpose, that we're going to get harvest from it, and that people aren't using public money to greenwash?
Mm-hmm. Well, I think a hugely important part of that is the Woodland Carbon Code, and I think the additionality tests that are set out as part of that as well, because we want to make sure that we have a system that people, that is ethical and that people can invest in and can rely on as well. We've made some changes through the Woodland Carbon Code and put in additionality tests as part of that as well, which I think have improved that scheme. But I think in terms of those specific examples, I'm happy to follow up, because there are all sorts of different clawbacks that can be taken from schemes as well. So I'd be happy to look into that and get further information and furnish the committee with that as well, in terms of I suppose how we're monitoring those schemes. I don't know if that's the wider point that you're getting at as well.
Yes, yeah. Monitoring them, making sure if the work isn't done and that's not providing a public good, that the money comes back and that it shouldn't be used for greenwashing pollution elsewhere.
Mm-hmm, absolutely. And I don't have any forestry colleagues here with me today, so I'm happy to follow up with more information on that.
Thanks. Just to end this session, you sound very positive about forestry, but in reality, a 40% cut in the Woodland Grant Scheme has had a dramatic impact on our forestry sector. And in the programme for government, it was stated there would be at least 10,000 hectares, but the official target prior to that was 18,000 hectares. So that's a huge cut. And it'll not only have an impact on the government's climate change target, especially if those 18,000 hectares were fast-grown conifers. One of the biggest issues is we have a forestry industry that has seen an increase in employment by 30% since 2015. But the message that the government are sending out doesn't really put much confidence into the sector, and that the investment in the sector depends on that confidence going forward in future wood supplies. So what's your vision after March? So there's no indication of what targets or whatever are going to be after March. So it's a long-term industry. What's your vision for forestry? Is it to remain at 10,000 hectares, or are we looking to get back to the targets at 18,000 hectares?
I mean, I absolutely appreciate and accept the points that you've just made to me. And I think I've been quite honest and transparent about the fact that there's no getting away from it. I mean, it was a big cut to the forestry grant scheme this year, which has undoubtedly had an impact. And it's also particularly disappointing at a time when we think, you know, we saw our highest ever planting levels at 15,000 hectares, which is a massive achievement, to then have to reduce that to 10,000 hectares. That's certainly not where I want to be. I've had numerous discussions with industry, with other organisations on the back of that, because, you know, quite understandably, there was a lot of concern about that. And like you say, about the overall confidence of the sector as well. Now, of course, I can't say at this stage, we don't have a budget for next year. I can't say what's going to be available. What I do have, though, is a positive vision for the future of forestry in Scotland. Of course I do. Again, I would like to see those rates increase and improve that trajectory, because it was on a clear trajectory to increase at that point as well. But again, you know, I absolutely accept that the cuts have had an impact, and unfortunately we're not able to meet the targets that we'd initially set out.
So what can you say to the industry to give them that confidence that the trees that they're growing at the moment, the seedlings that they're planting or whatever, that there is going to be support and those targets are going to rise in the future. What's your vision? So I know we don't know what the budget is, but what's your vision for future planting?
I mean, again, I've been engaging with industry in relation to that, as have officials in Scottish Forestry too, because there are strong relationships that exist there. I can only reiterate what I've already said, and I hope that we do get back on that positive trajectory, because I do think it is a hugely important sector for Scotland, and I do think we do have so much more potential in that regard, not just for our wider economy, but also for our when you think of the wood products, I think the circular economy that comes from forestry and the wider industry itself, as well as meeting our emissions targets too. So again, that's where I said earlier that the key focus for us this year though has been ensuring that we are getting the absolute maximum value for what we can from the funding that's available this year, and I very much want to continue that going forward.
Okay, thank you. Ariane Burgess.
Thanks, Nina. I've got a number of questions in this area. I just want to kind of circle back to pick up on some bits that my colleague Emma Harper brought in, and it was around the fact that at the moment we import a lot of timber into Scotland, and something that I've been trying to get to the bottom of, a bit technical, is the fact that we could be using more of Scottish timber for building housing, for example, and that would need to be engineering specifying C16, and what they currently specify is European Scandinavian grown timber, C24, and I've been trying to get to the bottom of this because I think it could unlock an incredible amount of potential for the sector in terms of, you know, Scotland already is doing a great job in terms of timber frame housing in Scotland, but they don't do that south of the border. So that could be an incredible opportunity for forestry in Scotland, but somebody needs to kind of push that a bit further and try to kind of understand why that's not happening, why that's not being specified. So I'd really appreciate if you can do something about that.
And I think, well, that's a particular area I'd be happy to follow up with you on, and perhaps have a meeting with forestry officials regarding if that would be of interest.
Yeah, thank you. And then just to come back on the RSE report. So, yes, we did have discussions, and one of my amendments, as you know, was requiring forestry schemes over 50 hectares to conduct an EIA as a condition of public funding. And this would have ensured that the majority of land managed for forestry is managed responsibly while affecting only a minority of forestry schemes. And I'd be interested to hear if you could outline why the Scottish Government takes a position that large-scale forestry projects don't need to conduct an environmental impact assessment, unlike most other sectors.
I know that this was a topic that we'd covered in some of the discussions that we'd had previously. I think that, and just to outline, that every project that's above 20 hectares has to go through an EIA screening process. And if it's found likely to have a significant effect, then an EIA would be required for that project. Now, there aren't very many EIAs at the moment, and I think that that has been taken as a sign that the system isn't working, whereas that's actually more of a sign that the system is, because of all the modelling and all the screening that has to be undertaken through these woodland projects anyway. So Scottish Forestry colleagues work closely throughout that process of the woodland creation to make sure that all the mitigations are in place and that they're in as strong a position as they can be. So that then means by the end of that process an EIA may not be required because all those mitigations have been put in place. So that's fundamentally why we hadn't agreed to those amendments earlier. And we also didn't want there to be a chilling effect in tree planting, which we have seen in other areas, or where it's acted as a deterrent for some of the smaller planting schemes to come through.
Okay. So maybe there's some misunderstanding. And you mentioned earlier communication between Scottish Forestry and RSE and how that was happening during the ARC bill. However, I understand from RSE that meetings are not being picked up. So if you could encourage that, because I think if it's a miscommunication, a misunderstanding, it would be great if more communication could happen between them. Because I think their report has a lot of very good ideas in there for the future of Scottish forestry and how we can do it better. But we need that communication.
Absolutely, I'm more than happy to pick that up with officials. And as I say, you're right, there were some good points in that report, and some of them have already been acted on or implemented through some of the measures that I've outlined today. But yes, I'd be happy to follow that up with officials.
And finally, something that I've become aware of in the sector is polarisation, which seems to happen across a lot of the sectors in the rural area. And I've had conversations with people quite high up in Scottish Forestry around this, quite concerns about it beginning to happen. And I think it's happening in the space of commercial forestry and then conservation. And I'd love to hear what the government's thinking about in terms of how we've got that fantastic model of the Common Ground project with the deer management. What can we do around preventing polarization and really getting people together to talk about what is really a shared issue of how do we make sure that Scotland's woodlands and forestries thrive, that people come into a sector on all of it, from the seed planting all the way through to conservation, etc. How do we make sure that people come into a sector or sectors that is actually, you know, talking together and sharing these ideas and best practice and leadership?
Mm-hmm. No, you're absolutely right. And there has been an awful lot of work that's been ongoing in relation to that as well. I touched on some of that work earlier in my previous response to Emma Harper, but I was talking about particularly the community engagement element. And I think there are some projects where, you know, they do a really good job in terms of that wider engagement and involving people in that process. And there are other applications where, you know, that simply isn't the case. So we want to make sure that is, you know, that good engagement is really the standard that we see for some of the applications that are coming forward too. So again, we are constantly striving to try and improve these processes. And I think do exactly what you've set out there, because I think there are multiple benefits to be gained through forestry if it's done in the right place and in the right way, and I think it's getting that right that's critical.
Thanks.
Rachel Hamilton.
Cabinet Secretary, I'm listening to what you're saying to Ariane Burgess on community engagement with regards to the commercial forestry plantations, but that hasn't happened on the government purchased estate in Glenprozen for £17.6 million, has it? When Mary McCallan talked about how wonderful this was going to be, she talked about community, she talked about biodiversity, and she talked about environment. But we're hearing reports from the Glen that the houses that once housed people and created jobs are no longer, and those houses are now in disrepair, and the Glen is being depopulated. So as well as an environmental impact assessment, what is the government doing to ensure that public money to the tune of 17.6 million is ensuring that communities are benefiting as well?
I mean, that's certainly not what I've heard in relation to that, but I'm happy to follow up with you in relation to that too. But I believe that Forestry and Land Scotland has been undertaking consultation and engagement in relation to their land management plan, which is very much about involving local communities in terms of the future plans that they envisage for that overall estate, because I do think that that's what we expect landowners to undertake. I think we've got to try and lead by example in relation to our public organisations and how they undertake that work as well. So I do think that wider involvement is hugely important. It's what I would expect to take place as well.
Would the Cabinet Secretary be willing to make sure that what you're saying and hearing from FLS is actually true? Because that the jobs have gone, the houses are in disrepair. And I think it's important that we recognise that what is you're being told is actually not reality.
But I think that there's a few important areas within that as well. I mean, obviously, when the estate changed hands, there would have been, there are times when... specific times when Forestry and Land Scotland wouldn't have been able to engage with the people that were living on the estate because of when that transaction was taking place. But again, I'm more than happy to follow up with those details because I think it's important to get the facts of all that correct. And certainly we don't want to see people or depopulation of the glens, if anything. We want to see the opposite and people being encouraged to come into that space, which is, I think, very much the approach that they're taking and what they're trying to set out. But of course, I investigate any concerns and I take that really seriously. I've got to. I think that's an important responsibility. So again, I'm more than happy to follow up with you in relation to that.
Thank you. We're making good progress, so I'd suggest we take a 10-minute comfort break, and then we'll come in and tackle the big challenge that is fisheries. So I suspend this meeting until 10:20. OK, we're now going to resume the session, and our next theme is fisheries, and a question from Rhoda Grant.
Thank you, Convener. The Cabinet Secretary will be aware of press reports with regard to modern slavery on fishing fleets. I wonder what action she is looking to take to make sure that that doesn't happen, for one, and that workers both in fishing and agriculture that maybe not local and are coming from distance are properly looked after, and that the employers comply to UK law and take seriously their employer responsibilities towards those people.
You've raised a really important point there, and I think hugely important issues. And I think, just to make clear right from the outset, that we of course condemn any trafficking of people or exploitation of those who work in this country. We had strengthened the law in relation to that in 2015 with an act which gave the police more powers and really just tried to strengthen the law in relation to these kind of offences, for one. But undoubtedly, issues exist there that we need to try and address. I think turning to, I know you raised that in relation to fisheries, first of all, and I think there's a few issues to touch on and raise there, but particularly in relation to agriculture, you'll be aware of course, the points that have been raised by Richard Leonard during the discussions that we'd had in the agriculture bill, and I think some of the issues that had surfaced around that time. We support the Workers Support Centre, and I think they'd highlighted some concerns with us as well, and I met with them through the course of discussions on that bill. Now, this is an area that straddles a few different policy areas. I'll actually be meeting with Richard Leonard. I think that's due to take place next week, together with the Housing Minister, so that we can try and address those problems where they exist. Because quite generally, I think when it comes to housing policy, we should, and I think I'd said that during the course of the debate on the Agriculture Bill, that we should expect the same standards of accommodation for people, regardless of where they're from or what job they're working in. And that is the ultimate aim with the policies we're developing. But I think what that did go to highlight, and from discussions in the bill as well, that there are gaps there that we need to try to work together to address. So I'm hoping with the meetings that will be initiating next week, that will be a step towards doing that. And I also know that this is a matter that the Housing Minister is considering too. Now, in relation to the fishing industry as well, I mean, I think part of the problem there is, of course, the use of transit visas for people, which ultimately means that the various laws that would apply to workers here don't apply to those working under a transit visa. And we'd raise concerns about this to the UK government as well, and about the use of those visas. We want the fishing industry to be an attractive career of choice for people that they choose to work in. I think there are a number of different initiatives that the industry themselves have worked on to try and get more people to work across the industry. But we absolutely have to do what we can to tackle these issues where we know they exist. And obviously, if there are any prosecutions, that's for the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service and Police Scotland to pick up and deal with. But of course, we condemn any of that behaviour, and we want to make sure that people are working in suitable conditions when they come to live and work in this country.
I suppose the difficulty is, especially in fishing, identifying people because they're at sea for a lot of the time. And I wonder if the Cabinet Secretary has given any thought to how better to interact with crews to make sure that they aren't in slavery, but they also that their conditions are reasonable. And I wonder if maybe the marine protection vessels could be involved in that, if they're working with boats at sea. Have they had any training in dealing with those issues? And, what steps is she taking to try and protect people who are in a very vulnerable situation?
Well, I think I'll pass to Ian, who may have more information, I think, particularly from the, as you say, with the marine protection vessels and that side of things.
Yeah, thank you, Cabinet Secretary. So in terms of training, there's no... We're looking at options in terms of training. That also sits with the powers that our officers on the marine vessels actually have. What I would say that if they did spot something that was a concern or raised a concern, it may be a police matter as opposed to a marine protection issue. We've got mechanisms through our intelligence process to then share that with Police Scotland. So if we did spot something on a boarding, we'd be able to share that intelligence and pass that through to Police Scotland.
Okay. Emma Roddick.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary. So the Cabinet Secretary will be aware, as I've raised already, some comments from fishermen in Shetland around the advising of quotas and that happening far enough in advance that fishermen are able to plan. I hope that she'd be able to give some comments around how it can be improved in future and that fishermen aren't, you know, as they put it, just fishing on a hope and a prayer until they know what the quota is that they're working to.
I appreciate that point, and just to say in relation to that, I think that's in reference to the additional quota that we receive. We'd had a consultation on that at the start of the year. We'd received a number of responses to that as well, and there were quite a few options that were contained within it. And that ultimately makes up 11% of the overall quota that is allocated to industry in terms of the fishing opportunities. So I appreciate the frustration about the time that had been taken to confirm that. Unfortunately, it had just been a case of ensuring that we were working through what were quite detailed responses to that consultation before allocating it. But of course, we'll always look to learn from these processes. I appreciate that that was difficult for industry, but of course, we'd look to provide them with that information as soon as possible.
Grateful for that reassurance. Inaccurate labelling and other landing documentation is also a big concern, particularly where vessels are landing in one place but selling elsewhere. Could she speak to improvements in inspections and the rate of inspections at landing sites to verify catches?
I'll hand over to Ian, who'll be able to provide some more of the detail and information in relation to that. But I think one thing I would say is that we proactively publish a lot of the information in relation to the work that we undertake so that we are entirely transparent with that in terms of the level of inspections. And because it has been an area in the past where I've received quite a lot of correspondence on, or there's been that feeling that some vessels are being treated differently to others, which I think from the work we've undertaken, that's been shown not to be the case. I think there has been, overall, there's been nearly 4,000 intelligence reports received, about 2,000 different inspections. Some of that equates to massive increases in the overall inspection rate. I think a 50% increase in the number of intelligence reports that have been received, and all of that has been because of the prioritisation that's been put in relation to that. Also, in relation to the checks, of course, that's done on a risk basis in some areas, but again, Ian will be able to provide more of the detail on that.
Yeah, thank you. As Cabinet Secretary said, we're looking at our overall operating model and looking for ways to continually improve that. So in terms of the boardings and inspections, we have a big focus on trying to drive our productivity. Mm-hmm. So compared to 2022 and 2023, we saw a 36% increase in our boardings at sea. We saw a 39% increase in our inspections. That's coupled with, as Cabinet Secretary said, we're looking at how we improve the model from end to end. So at the front end, it's about gathering more intelligence that then informs how we prioritise our efforts in the best way. We then have documentation checks prior to landings. For example, all non-UK vessels are checked before they land into the UK. And we then look at what we then do at sea, what we track through the VMS as well. And then we have checks that happen once the landings have taken place. One area we're continued to try and improve is where a vessel is landing into the EU or other countries, and we're doing a piece of work now to start to strengthen the data sharing in there, because again, that will strengthen that model and that assurance that we've got around that all vessels are being compliant, and where there are issues, we're taking action at the right time.
Great, thank you. Just finally, we heard last week about the possibility of the Marine Directorate using quota to raise revenue and incentivise change of behaviour. Is the Marine Directorate currently able to do that, and what percentage of quota is allocated in that way?
Again, I don't know if that's in reference to the additional quota there, but I'll pass over to Malcolm.
No, could you just expand on the context in which you heard that?
So last week we received evidence around how revenue could be raised by the Marine Directorate by using quota and making changes, incentivising kind of change in behaviour amongst those who are working and ensuring sustainability.
So, I mean, that is a potential, but there are no immediate plans around that.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you. Beatrice Wishart.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning. And I'd like to ask about fisheries management plans. we know that the Fisheries Policies Authorities are to jointly publish individual fisheries management plans, or FMPs. There's always initials and abbreviations. There's a list of 22 that are being led by the Marine Directorate, and they need to be published by the end of 2024. DEFRA had published for England and Wales its first five in December 2023. So could I ask what progress is being made on the fisheries management plan for Scottish waters?
Yes, absolutely. So, first of all, to highlight, there are 21 FMPs that are being led by Scotland, and there are another couple that were taken forward jointly with DEFRA. I think this has been, admittedly, a really complex piece of work, and it's required, of course, stakeholder engagement. It means working across the different UK administrations as well, not to mention all the variety of different assessments that have to be undertaken as part of that as well. So that includes like some of the conservation advice and also strategic environmental assessments as part of that as well. We also have to consider as part of that process the wider interaction with other policies and other pieces of legislation too. So it is a really complex picture to try and work through in the development of these plans. And on top of that, of course, I mentioned the engagement and how important that is. We also need to be able to consult on those plans as well. As you've mentioned, the deadline for those plans is coming up towards the end of this year. I would say some of the challenges that we're facing in relation to the FMPs that we're producing in Scotland are shared by the other UK administrations. I know you mentioned some of the FMPs that have been published there, but I think generally we're all kind of coming up against some of the same problems when we've been working through this process as well. So we're currently in discussion with the other UK administrations, and I hope to be able to provide more of an update to the committee in due course in terms of the overall timelines for those.
Could you expand a wee bit more on what the challenges are then for all the administrations?
Again, it's just some of those challenges that I've broadly outlined. It's all the various assessments, the interaction with legislation, the engagement that needs to be undertaken in putting these together. Also the fact that we do need to do that wider consultation. So it's trying to ensure that we've been building in the time to enable all of that to happen, because I think if we were to introduce the fisheries management plans, we want to make sure we're getting them right and they're as thorough as what they need to be. I would say, though, that in the absence of the fisheries management plans, that doesn't mean that we're not actively managing our fisheries. And obviously, we do continue to do that. And the fisheries management plans, I think, will help provide more transparency around that. But again, we've encountered these complexities through that process. So I will be writing to the committee with further updates on that in due course.
I mean, One of the things that obviously concerns fishermen is the spatial squeeze, and it's quite significant, obviously, around the North Sea, and the competition that's being faced with renewables, offshore wind, and developments in the blue economy. Is that going to impact the work that's being done for the fisheries management plans?
I mean, again, I've outlined just some of the assessments and the different interactions that need to be taken into consideration here. So there's a variety of different factors as to why this work has taken, I think, longer than has been anticipated. I appreciate the points that you're making about the pressures that exist in the marine space. Of course, the National Marine Plan 2 is currently being developed as well, and that's ongoing, and that's being led by the Acting Cabinet Secretary for Net Zero as well. And I think updates were provided to that work just last month, and I think the timescales that are being looked at there, where it will consider a lot of these issues. But again, we are still proceeding with this work. We're trying to do it as best and as thoroughly as we can. But again, I will provide further updates to the committee on how that work is progressing. Thank you.
Thank you. Just to go on further from that, it's my understanding that the draft management plans need to be laid on the 7th of October, and then the whole process completed by the end of the year. Given what you've said, it sounds unlikely that's going to be the case. So are you going to be requesting that the joint fisheries statement actually has changed to reflect that and push the date back?
And that's where I'm going to provide a further update once I've confirmed what that's going to look like. I will be providing that information to committee and writing to you with that.
Okay, so it will be likely that date will slip.
Well, again, we found the deadlines really hard to stick to. And again, it's a problem that we're facing across the UK at the moment. So we're having those discussions, and I will update the committee on that programme of work.
OK, thank you. Rachel Hamilton.
Just to follow on from Beatrice Wishart's questioning, yesterday on Farming Today, Mike Cohen of the NFFO, the National Federation of Fishermen's Organisations, I don't know if you managed to catch it, was talking about how important it was to put an evidence-based scientific approach to making decisions around FMPs. And I just wondered how that squares with the reduction in budget for research and science, as you will have heard from the evidence session last week, and how important it is to ensure that fishermen are able to provide food to put on our plates.
Well, what I would say is I think the point about the evidence-based decision-making is absolutely right. And again, that's part of that's factoring into the work that we're taking forward on the FMPs as well. So I wouldn't disagree in relation to that, because I think that's hugely important. And again, we want to make sure that we're basing the fisheries management plans on the best available evidence that we have. And I think the stocks that we've focused on initially have been those ones where we have that wider set of information available.
OK, thanks.
Colin Beattie.
Cabinet Secretary, I'd like to ask a few questions around the UK-EU trade and cooperation agreement. We can't seem to get away from Brexit and these things. The agreement covers a lot of different issues about fishing itself, quotas, days at sea and so on. Now, ultimately there was a transitional arrangement agreed, which comes to an end in 2026. I'd like to ask just a couple of questions. There seems to be the potential for renegotiating those fisheries arrangements. I'd like to ask, firstly, on the original agreement where the transitional arrangement was put in place, to what extent was the Scottish Government involved in these negotiations? And secondly, are there discussions currently with the new UK Government regarding the priorities of Scottish fishermen and the involvement of the Scottish Government in these negotiations? Fisheries is a much larger issue, I think, in Scotland than it is south of the border, so it would be appropriate if we were in there.
No, I absolutely agree with you. I would say that in relation to the forthcoming TCA, I think we certainly don't want to wait until that time comes before putting our position across, and I think our expectations of what that should look like. What I would say is that I've had one brief initial meeting with the Deputy Secretary of State, Steve Reid. That was just after his appointment in the summer. Both myself and the Minister will be meeting with the UK Government on Monday, together with the other devolved administrations, which is hopefully a bit of a reset in relationships with the UK Government, which I think is what we've needed. And I think where we'll be able to start to approach these issues and ensure that we're making our interests and the areas that we see as important, and making all of that known to the UK Government. Of course, fisheries is disproportionately important to Scotland, to our wider economy, so we want to make sure our interests are represented in that as far as possible. And we also have some other expectations, I think, as part of that too. Because obviously, together, well, as part of any future TCA, and we've set out our position in relation to what a veterinary agreement could look like and the SPS. We think that could certainly be improved, and I think the soundings from the UK Government at the moment are certainly sounding like they want to head in that direction as well, so that we can remove some of the barriers to trade that we have with the EU. But I think we're clear in any discussions that we have with the UK Government, none of that should be at the expense of the industries that are important to us in Scotland. But I think us having a seat at that table and ensuring we're feeding in is hugely important, and that's certainly what I'll be seeking through my engagement with the UK Government.
And just to come back to my first question, which was about the original agreement, was the Scottish Government involved in the negotiations for that?
Not as far as I'm aware, but I don't know if Malcolm has any further information.
I don't think directly, but we will have had conversations with counterparts in relation to it at that time.
Okay. Now, the transitional arrangement finishes in 2026. Are there any implications for Scottish fisheries in that? Any little attachments there that we should know about? Or is it just straightforward, it's reached that point and...
Well, I hope we would be in a position before that point, if we're able to enter those discussions, that we'll obviously would hope you'd have some knowledge in advance of that as to what the future picture is going to be. But
Is there a position that the Scottish Government wants to reach on this, or in terms of improvement of Scotland's position in terms of these arrangements?
In relation to the whole of the TCA, more broadly, yes, of course. I mean, I've mentioned one of the areas as an example of that, which is reaching a veterinary agreement with the EU. We think that that would be very beneficial. We think there would be all sorts of different... also just trying to remove some of the red tape, and I think which has been a real barrier for us to trade. So I think that we could certainly improve on that. When we look at youth mobility as well, I think that's been something that we had wanted to continue to seek with the EU, and I think that there are opportunities to enhance that as well. And obviously within all of that, we want to make sure that we're getting the best deal possible, whether that's for our fisheries or for our other industries in Scotland.
Certainly red tape has been a big issue that's come up about the seafood trade and so on. However, just recently, the UK government's postponed bringing in additional red tape for fruit and vegetables and so on coming from the EU because of the administration problems, but they still intend to bring it in next year. So what hope is there to reduce the red tape in terms of our fisheries industry?
Well, I think just more broadly, I mean, we have seen some issues and we still have some outstanding issues with the UK government when it comes to the border target operating model. I think that, you know, it's within all our best interests, and I think that we accepted the model as it was when it was published, because we know that we need to have biosecurity measures in place at our borders. And there was an unlevel playing field in terms of what was going out of the UK compared to what was coming in and how those goods were being treated. But we do have gaps in that, which is what we've been trying to pursue with the UK government. And again, discussions that I hope to hold with the new Secretary of State, where we have a gap on the West Coast in terms of what's moving from Ireland and Northern Ireland. That's been because of the interactions with the Windsor framework, and the checks, I think, were due to be implemented by the end of October, which obviously doesn't leave much time either for industry to prepare. So we've been seeking some clarity on that. I believe that that timeline is scheduled to move, but again, these are part of the discussions that we'll be having, because we need that urgent clarity for industry so they know what to expect and whether or not this the timeline for that is going to shift. So, again, these will form part of the discussions that we'll have with the UK government, because we want to make sure that we do have that appropriate balance of measures in place, but where it's not putting in an undue burden on our traders either.
Do you think there'll be an opportunity to widen the discussions to cover things like labour shortages and so on?
That again, just in particular in relation to that with the UK government, I mean, we've had proposals for quite some time in relation to, I think, some of the labour issues that we know exist across Scotland. And particularly in our rural communities, we had put forward plans for a rural communities visa pilot, which had been largely endorsed by a number of different political parties, as well as the Migration Advisory Committee as well, who saw merit in that. So I think that given the reset in relations that we have with the UK government, we can start to look at some of these ideas that we've had previously so we can improve that situation.
Do you have any feel as to when this renegotiation might start, or when some progress might be seen on it?
In relation to some of these issues, I'm not going to know that much beyond the meeting that we have on Monday. But again, this is the start of a new relationship, I hope, with the UK government, where we can hope to progress some of these matters.
Thank you.
Ariane Burgess.
It's good to hear about all the work the Marine Directorate is undertaking. Nevertheless, the Directorate is currently failing to deliver its statutory duties under the 2020 Fisheries Act, among other legislation, to achieve good environmental status in Scotland's waters. Can I ask, to what extent is this due to budgetary reasons?
I don't know if there are a number of different factors at play. I mean, we do have some work that's outstanding that we have been delivering on. Again, some of this cuts across other portfolios and the work that both Alistair Allen and Gillian Martin would be leading on in relation to the implementation of the management measures for the outstanding marine protected areas for our priority marine features as well. Now, I think the consultation has been open on the offshore MPA areas and what that will look like. But of course, there are still the inshore areas too. I think that work has taken longer than anticipated, purely because it is just really complex. And I think it's dealing with over 160 different sites as well and trying to assess the impacts of what any management measures might be. So that has been a really complex piece of work, which undoubtedly is taking time to deliver. Now, of course, resources across the whole of government, I mean, there are pressures on headcount. We have to work towards our priorities as best we can, and we are managing across some of our key priority areas to progress these areas as quickly as we can. But there's no getting around some of the natural complexities that exist within some of that work that can also prevent it accelerating at any quicker pace.
In terms of the work that needs to be done and that complexity, do you think that budget allocation has been underestimated?
Again, I think, just as I was outlining with FMPs, I think some of that, when we'd set out initial timelines for work, there are various things that can happen in between time, which officials have to deal with. And it means that they can't progress that work in the way that they would have done. So I think, you know, we try to deal with these various pressures as and when they arise, while still delivering on the programme of work that we've set out.
Okay, so I think you might be hinting at my next question, which is during the roundtable last week, a few stakeholders spoke about how communication and transparency with the Marine Directorate has become increasingly difficult. And when asked why statutory requirements have not been met, the Marine Directorate has at times pointed to too many freedom of information requests as well as a judicial review, using up its time and resources. And it could be asked, you know, if the Marine Directorate is inundated with FOIs, this could perhaps be because they're not being as open and transparent as a public body should be. So I would like to ask, how are FOI requests managed? Is the volume of FOIs indicative of a failure in transparency and partnership working with stakeholders? And what is the Marine Directorate's position on publishing data collected using public money, for example, from projects funded by the Marine Scotland Fund?
Okay, there's a lot within that question. I think there are some specific points within that I would have to follow up, and I'd be happy to set out in correspondence to the committee as well in relation to the overall letter there. I mean, I think it is difficult because, of course, there is a lot happening in the marine space, and I think we've touched on some of that in previous questions in the committee as well. It's also an increasingly polarised space as well, which can make progressing some policies that we're taking forward, it can make that quite difficult. But of course, we do put a really strong focus on the engagement that we have with our stakeholders. And there are strong relationships that exist there. What we have tried to do is put some of the bodies that we have for engagement across the piece on a more strategic footing. When you look at the refresh that we've done of the Fisheries Management and Conservation Group as an example, there's also the Regional Inshore Fishery Groups as an example of that too. We'd had a refresh of that. We've obviously got to monitor that and see if it's working and delivering as everybody, I think, hopes it would. But there's also when I mentioned the FMAC 2 and the various subgroups that exist within that, that's been put on a more strategic footing. It meets more regularly with the terms of reference. And those measures are bedding in. But I do think that we do have those opportunities for our stakeholders to feed into our decision-making processes as well. And of course, I meet with our variety of different stakeholders as well. And I think that is important, and maintaining those relationships is very important too. I don't know if there's anything further that you want to add as part of that, Malcolm.
Yeah, just one point. To build on what was already said in terms of the polarised context and the number of FOIs and the IRs, and often it's the complexity of the cases rather than the sheer volume that does present some challenges, because these things have to be prioritised. On the point about kind of transparency, as a directorate, we are looking at what we can more proactively publish ahead of time, so that, you know, it's there and stakeholders can get access to it, you know, readily. So that is a piece of work that's underway.
Could you say a bit more about how your FOI requests are managed? That's kind of helpful that you're saying it's not necessarily volume, it's the complexity of it. But how are the processes managed, or is that something that would be better to write to the committee on?
We can certainly outline that the process is probably not any different really from anywhere else in government. The cases will be allocated to a handler. They will then gather the information within the statutory deadline wherever possible and respond, where we then have reviews. They're allocated to a different part of the directorate for reviews and again within the time frame set.
And do they proactively take on the action of keeping the requester, the person who's made the FOI request, are they kept informed of the process, or is it one of those things where it disappears into the dark and you don't hear for a long time?
Well, typically, I mean, any request will get acknowledged in the first instance. Often, there may be follow-up correspondence to clarify a request. Sometimes that includes the offer of a kind of conversation to just understand what a particular requester is looking at. And then if there is any question of not meeting the deadline, and I think our rates at the moment are pretty good, actually, then again, we would be in touch with the requester.
Okay, thanks. And then you mentioned that you are looking at ways of being more transparent and looking at the data that you can publish. Are you having engagement with stakeholders to ask how it would be helpful for them to have that information shared?
Not specifically. I mean, I think we would have a sense of what it is they're wanting to see from the requests we get via FOIE or other means. It's just about getting stuff published, as I say, ahead of time.
And I think that's probably what led to, I mean, I talked about some of the enforcement activity and the inspections that are done there, and I think that's what led to the proactive publishing of that information as an example, because I think there were concerns around that, and we want to be open and transparent about the level of inspections that take place. So the decision was taken to proactively publish that information. So I think it just makes sense that we judge these when that arises.
In publishing data like that, does that create more of a is that a kind of budgetary consideration? Does that create more of a burden on the directorate to kind of do that work and make it public facing?
Not particularly.
No.
I think what we're doing touches upon what Malcolm said in the FOIs. We did invest a couple of years ago creating a central person to look at it to make sure we were learning lessons across FOI. So if there was a particular error, for example, where we were seeing a high volume, we would look at actually can we invest more in publishing stats and that, and the benefit is it reduces FOIs coming in that area. That's always in flux because there's different areas can start to capture FOIs, but it's back to the point I made earlier about we're looking at how we continuously improve this and increase that transparency at the same time.
Okay, that sounds good. So it would be great to be updated on the developments on that process. Yeah. Thank you.
Rachel Hamilton and then Beatrice Wishart.
Yeah, it's a supplemental on the scrutiny session that we had on the Marine Directorate last week. Elspeth MacDonald of SFF, Scottish Fishing Federation, said, and I quote, "Many of us feel that there has been a serious lack of investment of public money in our inshore fisheries. We have many data gaps and poor information in relation to many of our inshore fisheries compared with some of our other fisheries. So, therefore, Cabinet Secretary, a lack of investment in research and monitoring was a common theme throughout that this committee heard. Can she outline how effective delivery can be achieved in inshore fisheries with taking into account Elspeth MacDonald's comments?"
I mean, again, there's no getting around that, you know, the Marine Directorate and other directorates across government, you know, we're all under pressure, and the focus is on delivering on the priorities of the government within that. I mean, in relation to our inshore fisheries in particular, there are a number of pieces of work that are underway in relation to that. And of course, we aim to progress that as much as we possibly can. And I think it's about £9 million a year that we've been spending on when it relates to fisheries science as a whole. And I think that has been relatively constant over the course of the past few years as well.
Has the headcount gone down since Marine Scotland was changed to Marine Directorate?
Just to say there were no big change as a result of the name. I mean, that was just to better recognise that the Marine Directorate is a directorate of the Scottish Government. It's not a separate organisation. But I would have to get the exact head account figures. I don't have that to hand unless either Ian or Malcolm have that information. Yeah.
When will the head of Marine Directorate be recruited, the new head?
I don't know what the timescales are that are just now, because obviously Annabel Turpie has moved into a temporary position at the moment because of the various moves that exist. But sorry, Ian, did you have more to say?
I can answer that. I'm the new interim director for Marine. Hot off the press.
Very hot off the press.
Okay, I think that's useful for this committee. Yeah, just one other area that I'm slightly concerned about on the introduction of on restricting certain kinds of fishing gear across 20 sites in Scotland, and that has been indicated that it could cost the Scottish economy £66 million. So do you believe or are you worried that this is just introducing HPMAs by the back door?
That's certainly not the case. This is in relation to the consultation we have at the moment on the offshore MPAs and the management measures. I would say that this has been a piece of work that's been in development for a very long time, and it's the full range of management measures that were put forward as part of that consultation. But we've had extensive engagement with industry, and I think it's been over the course of the past five years or even longer than that for these proposals to come forward. So I would like to think that I know that some stakeholders have welcomed the fact that this has finally progressed and we are consulting on it. Again, this is a piece of work that's being led by another portfolio, but certainly not introducing HPMAs. I think we've made our position on that very clear.
Okay. Thank you.
Beatrice.
Thanks, Convener. Just in terms of fishery science, you'll be aware that some members of the committee had a visit to the science labs in Aberdeen a couple of weeks ago, and it was very useful. And we met with some very dedicated personnel there, and it was good to see the work that they were doing. But I have to confess, I was somewhat surprised at the building's environment in which they're working in. I wondered if that is having any impact on their ability to deal with the workload and the data and evidence gathering.
Well, I know that some other sites are being used as well, such as at Aberdeen University, and I know that there have been, having visited the site a few times myself, I know that there have been a variety of different issues with it from various storms and damage that have occurred there. But Ian, I don't know if you have any further information in relation to that.
Yeah, so in terms of the buildings, we're now looking at options and working with the state's colleagues for next steps, so a timeline should emerge in due course on that.
Thank you.
Thank you. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary and Minister. Cabinet Secretary, I've been in touch with you previously about the issues around skilled worker visas for our fish processing sector. This is something that has given them quite grave concerns, considering that possibly up to about 80% of workers are immigrant workers within the fish processing sector and some of the businesses within my constituency as well. Now, I do understand that this is a reserved issue, but has there been any talks with the new UK government in regards to what the Scottish government and them can perhaps come up with some ideas for the processing sector to have some confidence that the precarious nature of the increased threshold will cause them, might give them some alleviation from their stress at this time.
It's
been quite a big concern, as you know.
Oh, absolutely. And I'd met previously with Jimmy Buchan and with Andrew Brown more recently to discuss some of these matters, because I recognise just how acute some of the pressures are that our processing sector in particular is facing. And they've actually faced them for a number of years, and it's an issue that we have been trying to get some sort of resolution to during that time. Because I think the visa requirements that are expected, I think the language thresholds, we'd had a previous forum with the UK government where we had raised these issues, and I think we'd seen in other sectors where specific visas had been allowed, where there were shortages, but the same wasn't being applied to fisheries, which we didn't think was fair. So we did try and challenge that. Unfortunately, we didn't get anywhere with those proposals. But again, just as I talked about earlier in relation to some of the other proposals we'd had, whether that's for a rural visa pilot and progressing some of these ideas, I hope that in the spirit of the, you know, the new engagement that we'll have with the UK government, hopefully we can reopen some of these issues and revisit them with a hope to practical solutions where we can really try and address these problems that would really help our industry, in particular our processing sector. So of course I haven't had those discussions with the UK government yet, but I certainly will be engaging in that.
That's great, thank you.
Thank you. Just to finish this section on marine, as you're aware, there's been a two-year research programme into the cockle population in the Solway, and I believe there's going to be a report published very soon on the sustainability of the stocks there. will you be able to, on receipt of that, set out the government's approach on any future commercial cockling on the Solway?
I mean, obviously, in relation to that, I think we would have to look and see what is within the report before we determine any future approach. But, of course, as soon as I receive that, I'd be happy to keep you updated and informed on the next steps from there.
Thank you. We now move on to animal health and welfare. A question from Emma Harper.
Thanks, Convener. So Food Standards Scotland wrote to Health Committee in April about challenges for recruiting veterinarians. And I know that one of the challenges that they cited was there was a number of concurrent issues, many arising as a consequence of EU exit. So, and then, but there's also obviously concerns in how we look at food standards and on all of that. And when I'm thinking about the government's decision to not progress with establishing a Scottish veterinary service as well, so I'd be interested to hear a wee bit about that and, you know, how do we progress and support securing animal welfare in relation to all of that?
I mean, the work that's undertaken by our official veterinarians is, of course, hugely important. What I would say is, I'll touch on the point about the Scottish Veterinary Service first before passing over to either Jim or George, if they have more to add in relation to that. I've just been quite transparent with the committee in setting out the position. I do think that establishing a Scottish Veterinary Service is still ultimately where we want to be. We'd had a programme board that had scoped out that work and what could potentially be included in it. But unfortunately, we're just not in the position. We don't have the capital budget to be able to get that programme off the ground. So we just weren't able to progress with it. But of course, should that budget become available in future, then we would look to, of course, pick up that work, because I do think that would be what's in the best interest of Scotland, would be to have that service. In relation to some other of the points that is there, George, I don't know if there's more you want to add.
Just briefly. Food Standards Scotland position, there was discussion at the meat wholesalers event last week between the industry and Food Standards Scotland. You'll be aware that Food Standards Scotland have had to increase their fees this year, and a large part of that is the difficulty that they've had in securing workers. The model in Scotland is for the staff to be employed by Food Standards Scotland rather than relying on contractors generally being rather more expensive. But Food Standards Scotland were reporting last week that difficulties in securing visas, so even when they've identified the staff, getting the visas through the system is causing difficulties and an increased reliance on contractors rather than being able to work with their own staff. So again, something, as the Cabinet Secretary has said, for us to engage with the UK government. At the same time, you know, it's good, I think, just now, the first cohort of new students into the new sort of veterinary school in Aberdeen. So that might, in time, provide a sort of cohort of, you know, further cohort of domestic vets to be able to serve both in, you know, things like meat hygiene and official veterinarians and in the wider the wider industry. So there are things that are being done in Scotland to help us move away from maybe the over-dependence that we've had in the past on non-UK EU nationals.
I just add one minor point to that. During my discussions with Food Standards Scotland during the summer on the increase in fees, one of the issues that they did have was the fact that the UK government had raised the threshold for earnings to £48,000, which has added a considerable cost, which is then being passed on. And hopefully, as the Cabinet Secretary has already laid out, if we can get this reset in the relationship, we're meeting on Monday, and hopefully we can start some proper negotiation as to how we get over some of these problems, because it is definitely having an impact on Food Standards Scotland and the cost that is then being passed on. But there is a lot of good stuff going on, as George just outlined, the new cohort of vets that are coming in. There's the vet school that I attended earlier on this year. And I think there is a job to do to be talking about what a fantastic industry it is to be in and encouraging our young folk to get involved with it.
And it means continuing working with the Animal and Plant Health Agency, though, in order to make sure that animal welfare concerns and working with Food Standards Scotland. I mean, I know we're constrained because obviously visa applications and ability, that's controlled by Westminster. So is this another case for just another plea that we have greater control over and choice over our own visa system immigration for Scotland?
Well, clearly that would be our position, but it's not where we are at this moment in time. So we need to deal with the immediate problems that we have right now and work out what it is that we want to do in the longer term.
Okay, thanks.
Just on that, Minister, where is your main focus going to lie with increasing the number of vets? So there's obviously a long lead-in. You know, a vet will take 6 years plus to be fully qualified, and you don't need a vet to undertake some of the work that Food Standards Scotland requires. So sampling, testing, looking in the back of cattle floats or whatever. Would you consider looking at the 1966 Veterinary Act to look at if there's going to be changes there that would allow the vets to focus on the work that vets absolutely need to do, but the ability for potentially not fully qualified, if you like, personnel to do some of the other work. Is that something you would consider looking at?
I think the point that you've touched on there is right, because there's no one focus at the moment. There are areas that we need to try and find solutions to, and I'm open to looking at any potential solution that we can find to make sure that we've A, got a cohort of young vets coming into the industry, B, dealing with issues that we've got right now, and if there are particular areas that are causing us problems, then yes, I'm open to looking at all of that.
Okay. George.
Mentory, I think the Scottish Government has already set out its position that the Veterinary Surgeons Act does need to be reviewed. It was off its time. The veterinary industry has moved on a huge amount. It is a reserved matter, so it would be one that we would need to work with the UK government on. But I know that the BVA is firmly of the view that it needs to be reformed. And that might indeed, convener, as you say, open up the possibility. You know, one of the reasons why we have so many non-UK vets working in you know, official veterinarian capacity in the UK is because of the different structures of qualifications and the veterinary industry in those other countries that mean there is a ready supply rather than necessarily everyone being qualified to that, you know, the nth degree as they are here.
Thank you. Minister, I wonder if we can give us an update on your previous comments about considering the option of a licensing scheme for greyhound racing in Scotland.
We're still looking at all our options. As you know, there is a members' bill that has gathered support in the Parliament, and I don't think we will progress the pursuit of a licensing scheme at the moment until we see how that bill, that members' bill, progresses through the Parliament. But I'd be quite keen to see what this committee has looked for a long time at what the members' bill has been in greyhound racing. It's greyhound racing you're talking about. So I'd be quite keen to get the views of this committee and see what your considerations have been. The bill from Mark Ruskell will go through the process, and we will see where that develops and take it from there.
It's just, I suppose, it was on the back that you were considering that. It's a decision you as a minister will take on whether a licensing scheme would be something that the government would take on board rather than a decision for the committee to ask you to do that.
But, I'm not saying that you should ask me to do that, but I'm quite happy to hear your thoughts and your considerations, what you have, because you have scrutinised this as much as anybody else has, so I'm quite keen to hear what your thoughts are on it.
Okay. Also, in the programme for government, the previous programme for government, there was a commitment to look at extending the 2021 Statutory to Animal Licensing Framework. And in fact, the government consulted between July and September last year on those proposals. However, the current programme for government makes no mention, and there was also a cut in the budget for looking at animal licensing. What are your plans going forward with regards to that, given the consultation that was carried out last year?
I'm going to let George answer this in the interim.
I think the first stage of the the outcome of the work on animal licensing is the announcement just a couple of weeks ago to bring in licensing for canine fertility businesses. So, you know, we're looking at each of the... There were a number of proposals in that consultation. You know, we've looked at the responses on each of those, and the, you know, the first stage is progressing on the you know, canine fertility. So that's one where we see the, you know, the biggest challenges.
Okay, so whilst there was an announcement in the programme for government, that work that was announced previously is still continuing?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Emma Harper.
Just to come back, as we were talking about Windsor framework earlier, and I know it was created to benefit Ireland and Northern Ireland and promote continued good relationships cross-border, but you mentioned that there are West Coast challenges, so between the port of Cairn Ryan and Larne and Belfast. So I'd be interested in how the Scottish Government will seek to achieve support and negotiations with the UK Government on... how do we establish like better standards or phytosanitary, sanitary food standards, all of that that we've just been talking about previously?
Well, this has been a long ongoing piece of work, obviously, through all the discussions that we've had on the border target operating model as well. And I know that the committee will have received various pieces of secondary legislation that have been implementing the various different stages of it. Unfortunately, sometimes out with my control and at very last minute notice, they've come in. But I think that is part of the problem that we've got now, is that while the border target operating model has to an extent been implemented, it's not been implemented on the West Coast because of some of those outstanding issues there and the other interactions. So that's really what we're looking to clarify as a matter of urgency with the UK Government. And again, I'll be raising that when I meet with the DEFRA Secretary of State on Monday, because I think we need to have that urgent clarity as to what's happening there. As I said in a previous response, the checks are due to start, I think, at the end of October, as it's what's currently set out. So we need to give that urgent clarity to industry if that's going to be delayed and when that will be delayed and when we'll resolve some of these outstanding matters.
And we talked about like EU exit was claimed to reduce red tape, for instance, but is the fact that there are challenges moving forward, it's actually there's more red tape now? So it needs to get sorted with a matter of urgency.
Absolutely. Well, we've set out some of our proposals that we think would help alleviate some of that in relation to a future veterinary agreement or an SPS arrangement with the EU. That's something we've always sought for, and I believe, again, as I'd said previously, that the UK government are that's the direction that they're looking to go in as well. So hopefully we're pushing it an open door when we have those discussions. We had published our expectations just in recent weeks. It's available on our website, but I'd be happy to share that with the committee if you'd like to see it. I think just in terms of what we'd like to see in relation to an SPS agreement, what we think the benefits from that would be, because we do know that it's cost households, I think, £7 billion since Brexit in terms of the extra costs we're seeing as a result of that. So I think that we can be in a position where we can see the removal of some of these barriers to trade if we're able to progress with an agreement. So ideally, that's where we would want to be.
Okay, thank you. Thanks,
Convener. Can I just add, I also met with the devolved ministers from Northern Ireland and Wales, and they're both of the same view that we need to get clarification on what this is. I doubt if we're going to hit the 31st of October deadline. It's unlikely at this stage that will happen, but it's, again, I keep coming back to the fact that we're going to try to reset this relationship between the UK government and the devolved governments, because there's quite a clear message coming from all three devolved parts of the UK that this is an issue that we really need to get clarity on and get fixed.
Okay.
Cabinet Secretary, you said you were meeting the Secretary of State for Scotland on Monday. What's going to be your main priorities in those discussions?
Well, the DEFRA Secretary of State will be meeting on Monday. It's part of our interministerial group meetings. It's actually the first meeting of these that we've had in a year. So again, it's about that reset in relationships. It's also good that I think we'll be meeting in person to have these discussions as well. I've already set out in correspondence to the Secretary of State, I think, what some of our key priorities are. There are some urgent matters of clarification. Some of that I've outlined in relation to the border target operating model, future allocations of agricultural funding will be on the agenda as well. But of course, as with other IMG meetings, I'll circulate a communique on the back of that and update the committee on the discussions.
Okay, thank you. We'll now move on to next theme, and it's national parks. Just got a very brief question. So the government announced that there would be a commitment to a new national park or new national parks potentially. And the process started back in 2022. So we've had 2 years of building up the framework on how to take this forward. And as you know, Galloway was announced as the preferred option. But, you know, so that's quite some time, 24 months in the making, if you like. But the formal consultation, which will advise you on, you know, the decisions that you'll make, whether to designate or not, are over only a 12-week period, which is incredibly short, and right slap bang, that is going to be Christmas and New Year. So effectively, the 12 weeks is going to be significantly less than that. There's real concerns in Galloway that this process is now being rushed, given the uncertainties over the park boundaries, the uncertainty over the planning authority status of the National Park, along with a whole list of concerns. Would you give any consideration to delaying that final decision, given that it would appear that the timescales that are now being announced are far less than we'd previously been imagined that the process would take?
Well, I think set out that timescale, I believe that the report could be completed within that time. I would say that Nature Scott had actually just published yesterday, again, this is information I'm happy to circulate to the committee as well, I think an online page which is going to provide all the information about the engagement that they'll be undertaking, how people can make their views known as well. Because the engagement part is really critical for this process, because we want to know what people in Galloway think, you know, about all sorts of different issues, about the boundary, about the governance, about any potential powers a park might have. And indeed, do they want a national park in Galloway? I think that's one of the key questions we want to get to grips with as well. And I've been perfectly open and transparent about that. I don't have any agenda here. I genuinely want to know what people think, and I really hope people will engage in that process. So as I say, that information was published just yesterday. I'll circulate that to the committee so you have that available. There will be, and again, while there might be a formal consultation period, there is going to be further engagement opportunities throughout that process too. I'm not going to commit today to say that I'm necessarily going to extend that time period, because I don't know. I mean, if it transpires through that more time is needed, I'll have to consider that when the need potentially arises. But I would just encourage everyone to make sure that they have their view and they make their views known throughout this process.
As part of the process, would it not have been sensible to carry out a full and thorough investigation into how existing national parks have impacted on policy outcomes?
I've also made my position on that quite clear as well. I understand that there's a petition in relation to that in the Scottish Parliament at the moment. But of course, national parks are already accountable. They're accountable to their boards, to the Scottish Government. They also can report to the Parliament too. So I think we already have mechanisms in place that assess how our national parks, whether they're achieving their outcomes or not. And I believe that that's thorough enough. And again, in the development or what could be a new national park in Galloway, it's not necessarily, and it's not going to be, I think, a like for like. Our two national parks are very different. The proposal for Galloway would again be very different to what the other parks are. And again, it's for the people in Galloway to decide what they would want that to look like if they want a national park there. So I think all of that that's why this exercise that's being undertaken by Nature Scott at the moment is a hugely important part of the process.
Okay, thank you. Emma Harper.
Thanks. Just on the issues, I know the boundary that's proposed is quite a wiggly line, and it includes East Ayrshire and South Ayrshire in bits as well. But there's also real concerns that folks said, can we just get engaged directly face-to-face? It can't be a desktop exercise. And I know that Nature Scotland have committed to, you know, being on the ground about it. So is that can you provide assurance that the engagement for local people will be on the ground?
I think it needs, I understand the point that you're making in relation to that. I think that face-to-face engagement is really important. I'm more than happy to follow up with Nature Scott in relation to that. And of course, if you're hearing any concerns, then I do want to know about that and hear that directly. But I think, again, the open, transparent process where we openly engage with people is hugely important, because we want to hear those views. We need to hear those views as well. Just as you touched on in relation to the boundary, you know, is that right? I mean, obviously, we're dealing with the proposals that have been put forward by the nominating groups, but we are keen to hear all of these views.
Okay, thanks.
And very finally from me, you'll be pleased to hear. In your introduction, you touched on that the Natural Environment Bill may have policies in there which would influence the creation of another national park. And I presume that's because there's no time for the National Park 2000 Act to be amended. But what additional policies do you see the Natural Environment Bill containing pertaining to national parks?
Some of the proposals in relation to the national parks, I think the proposals that have been consulted on, I think that was earlier last year, if I'm right, Donald. It was about modernising some of the legislation that we have there and the aims of the national park. So again, I can't definitively tell you what is going to be in the Natural Environment Bill, because we're still working through that and seeing what proposals will be brought forward. But of course, I will be keeping the committee engaged on that, but we're considering all of that at the moment.
Okay, thank you. And finally, Beatrice Wishart.
Yes, a question about national outcomes. The government's currently carrying out a statutory review of national outcomes and says it'll create a more successful country with opportunities for all of Scotland to flourish. So could you outline how the specific needs and opportunities of rural communities are being considered in this review, and how those national outcomes will help rural communities to flourish?
I think just in relation to that and the national outcomes, I think, first of all, the review is helpful. And I think what we find with the national outcomes as a whole is that the indicators that we have against the outcomes, sometimes it's been hard to disaggregate what is urban data from the rural. So I think part of the work that's been undertaken is for us, we've introduced a rural data dashboard, which helps us deal with some of the issues that we've experienced through that as well. And it's also, I think it's important to highlight that the information that we're gathering through the rural data dashboard is also helping us in the delivery of the rural delivery plan that we touched on in earlier discussions as well, which of course will be setting out how we're delivering against each of the outcomes that are there. But of course, it's intrinsic to our work and what we do. I think we've got to deliver against the frameworks that exist. But again, it's about improving the data that will enable us to do that.
Digital exclusion is key across a range of national outcomes, from education and learning to healthcare, culture, equality and human rights. Yet in rural and island areas, people experience a wider digital divide compared to people in urban areas. I recently heard from a constituent who's been told she won't be connected to fibre broadband until 2028, many, many years behind the Scottish Government's original R100 deadline. So how is this being taken into account in the revised national outcomes, and how will that help towards tackling the digital divide?
What I would say is that we don't necessarily need to wait for a review of the national outcomes to be able to try and deal with some of these problems. I think, and if you've got particular circumstances that need to be looked into, then please do let me know and other relevant ministers. I think what's important is that we don't forget a lot of the work that's already ongoing. So our National Islands Plan, I think, is a good example of that, where broadband general connectivity is one of the strategic outcomes that we have in the current plan. We have to set out how we're delivering against that and the work that's being undertaken. And I appreciate that when you're living in a community that doesn't have access to fibre, you do feel really left out. But I would say that the general picture is that has been, the digital connectivity has generally been improving. But of course, if you're in one of the areas that it hasn't reached yet, then of course you're going to feel that more acutely. So we have to set out how we're delivering against that and the other outcomes. But also a lot of the issues, and some of which you've touched on there, is part of what we picked up through the consultation on the National Islands Plan last year, and through which we heard also loud and clearly that the National Islands Plan needs to be updated to reflect some of the current challenges that we know our island communities face. So again, that will be part of the work that will be taken into consideration and setting out some of these objectives in a new National Islands Plan, which we'll be publishing next year as well. But of course, that's island specific. And then I also talked earlier about a rural delivery plan and what that might look like. And of course, it's not going to be it's not going to replicate what's in the National Islands Plan, but of course it'll be setting out some of the challenges, what we're doing to address that across different policy areas as well for our rural communities in Scotland.
Yeah, I wouldn't like you to think that I was just majoring on the islands issue, because the connectivity issue is across rural areas.
Oh, absolutely. It doesn't need to be even that remote a place. I know of areas, particularly within my own constituency, or areas just literally on the outskirts of towns that haven't had that access yet through rollout. So, of course, we do have commitments to expand that, which we've done through our own funding as well, to extend that reach as much as possible. But I think in this day and age, digital connectivity is such a basic thing. And I think if we want to enable more people to live and work in rural Scotland and across our islands, then, of course, we need to be doing what we can to improve that.
Thank you.
Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you. On this specific subject, the Auditor-General, Stephen Boyle, has said that he's concerned that Scottish Government goals are not clear, measurable and achievable. And on the issues that Beatrice Wishart has raised about R100 completion across regions, there are other policies that were announced in Programme for Government in 21, 22, 23, Remote Rural and Islands Housing Action Plan. Obviously, Scotland has an issue with depopulation. The 20 million Rural Entrepreneur Fund, which is essential for succession planning, creating jobs, and the Missing Bew funding, as we have already talked about. So when will this committee be able to understand that the work done on the Rural Data Dashboard and the impact of the lack of delivery on these policies is having on the inequalities in rural areas?
First of all, I would refute what you've said there about a lack of delivery, because some of those areas you've mentioned we have delivered, including publishing the Rural and Islands.
Sorry, I'm just saying what Stephen Bolt said in his Auditor General.
I know, but you've raised those areas in the PFG as ones that haven't been completed, when I think it's just important as a matter of fact to outline that they have been. But of course, we've published the plan, it's about the delivery of that, because housing is a hugely important matter for our islands and across rural Scotland as well. Now, I hope you can appreciate a lot of the policy area. I'm not responsible for a number of these different policy areas, but of course part of my role is to ensure that we're working across government to deliver on them, which my other colleagues across government do. So, and I touched on earlier in relation to the Rural Delivery Plan, I mean, one of the key objectives of that is, you know, making sure that we're making evidence-based decisions and we can track our progress against that, which is why the work that we're doing on the key performance indicators is going to be really important there to help measure that progress too. And I think that makes it generally a lot more transparent.
Okay, so when will you be able to come to the committee to answer the questions around how those rural inequalities are being achieved and, you know, I suppose, what's the word, how equality in rural areas is being achieved?
I mean, that's obviously fundamental to the work that we do across government. I mean, if you're talking, so I've already outlined the areas that the Rural Delivery Plan is going to cover, and I've said that I would keep the committee updated on that, which I think will show across all these different areas. And I've touched on the National Islands Plan, which shows how we're delivering against these specific objectives. And of course, we have to undertake, just as a matter of course, through the different policies we implement, a whole number of assessments that have to look at a fairer Scotland duty. We have our equalities duties that we have to outline and show how we're meeting that and how we're constantly striving to improve that situation for people right across Scotland. So I think a lot of that is in published information that we have to provide already, but of course we're constantly striving to improve that situation.
Thank you. That concludes our questions for today. I'd just like to thank Cabinet Secretary, the Minister and your officials for attending today. We'll now move into private session, and I suspend the meeting for 10 minutes.